I didn't want to think about all what happened, so I just buried my past.
There were 38,000 Jews living in the northern part of Libya at the time. Today, there are none left, Maftel had. The community is totally extinct.
If somebody wants to understand what is going on in the Middle East, they have to understand the Jewish refugees from Arab countries.
Buried beneath the headlines of the Mideast conflict is the forgotten story of the region's indigenous Jewish communities. In 1945, up to 1 million Jews lived in the Middle East outside of the Palestine Mandate. Within a few years, only a few thousand remained. The ancient Jewish quarters of Cairo, Damascus, and Baghdad were once vibrant, bustling centers. Today, they are silent. This is the story of the thousands who fled their homes, who endured in refugee camps, and who today quietly carry the memory of a destroyed civilization.
I was in Los Angeles on a business trip. I was in a hotel. There was a young lady in her mid-20s. And I could tell from her name and from her looks that she was Egyptian. So I said, Ahlan wa sahlan. He said, oh, do you speak Arabic? I said, yes. And she said, why did you leave Egypt? I said, well, I'm Jewish. He said, oh, I didn't know that there were Jews living in Egypt. And I told her the whole story. And she was shocked.
Everybody already thinks of Jews as white Europeans. Not all Jews are European.
Lulwa Khazoum is the founder of the Jewish Multicultural Project and editor of The Flying Camel, an anthology of writing by Middle Eastern Jewish women. Her father is a refugee from Baghdad.
When I sing traditional Middle Eastern and North African Jewish music, people will often say to me, it sounds Arabic. And I say to them, you know, we're not called cousins for no reason. What is Middle Eastern North African has come to be known as Arab. And people forget that there are many other indigenous peoples from the region, and the Jews are one of them.
In the year 586 BCE, Babylonian armies destroyed Solomon's Temple in Jerusalem and exiled the Jews of Judea to Babylon, modern-day Iraq.
There was a short period in Jewish history where the Jews who were expelled from Palestine by the Babylonia had to be exiled to Babylon. So many, some hundreds of thousands of them, nobody knows exactly, had to go there.
My family is among the Jews who stayed on that land for the next 2,600 years until around 1950. Jews who stayed in the region are known as Mizrahim, which in Hebrew means Easterners. They either stayed on that land of Babylon, as my family did, or they migrated to lands throughout the region, whether it was Iran, whether it was Syria, Lebanon, Morocco, Tunisia, Algeria, and so on, the entire region.
The Babylonian Jewish Heritage Center near Tel Aviv is a museum established in Israel by Iraqi Jews to commemorate the achievements and destruction of their ancient community.
Now we are in synagogue, which is the very ancient synagogue in Baghdad. And this is part of the museum, which is in the center. It's a very successful museum of the exile.
Mordechai Ben-Porat is the museum's founder. Born in Iraq, Ben-Porat walked to Jerusalem by foot in 1945. A few years later, he was intimately involved in orchestrating the exit of 120,000 Iraqi Jews. Ben-Porat's museum celebrates the accomplishments of the ancient Babylonian rabbis who wrote the Talmud, a collection of Jewish law that shapes Jewish life to this day. The name of one of those ancient rabbis is enshrined today on college campuses all across America, where Jewish student centers are called Hillel, after a rabbi who lived 2,000 years ago in what is today Iraq.
The Jews were about 2,600 years in Iraq, and when they came to Iraq, they came before the Arabs, before the Muslims, of course.
This question of precedence in territories is a very fascinating one, because the many Arab countries say, we are Arab country, these Jews are like intruders from the outside, and therefore we hate them. That they could say in the Christian world, the Jews, for the most part, came to the Christian world after the war of Christianity. But in many of these countries, for example, North Africa, Egypt, Babylonia, Jews preceded the Arabs by many centuries, and sometimes by millennium.
In the year 622, a new religion emerged out of the Arabian Peninsula. Within a few years, Arab Muslim armies had conquered most of the Middle East. Mizrahi Jews found themselves referred to by an Arabic word, Dimmi.
A Dimmi, or a Dhamma, depending on the pronunciation, is a tolerated people. It's the people of the book, Christians and Jews, people who worship, practice the Bible. And according to Islam, this is a group that's supposed to be protected. What that means is, as Islam conquered the entire Middle East, North African region, and killed people in the name of Islam if they would not convert, the Jews and Christians would be spared their lives. However, they always had to be both physically and metaphorically inferior. For example, a Jew could not ride a horse, because then his head would be higher than that of a Muslim. Jews could not build a synagogue higher than a mosque.
All houses in Yemen, I mean the Jewish houses, must be lower, far lower than the Muslims. If God forbid one of the houses is a little bit higher than the of the Muslims, it will be pulled down. You see, the dhimma, as I said, is juridical. It's very precise, but it has also economic, political, and social repercussions. And there are many of them. One, for example, the Jews and the Christians, by the way, had to wear special items of clothes in order to differentiate themselves. For example, the yellow patch. That's not a Nazi invention. It was invented back in the 8th century, and the Jews and the Christians were forced to wear it. The Jews and the Christians could not ride the horse, because horse is a noble animal. Only Muslim can. Jews and Christians had to ride the donkey or to walk on foot. And Jews and Christians could not build any house of prayer, new one. And even if they wanted to refurbish the old ones, they had to have a special permission. And even when they got permission, it could not be higher than the nearest mosque, in order to demonstrate exactly the point that Islam is supreme and nothing can be seen to compete with it. That's the issue.
This whole idea of Dimmi is permeated in Arab culture. It goes all the way back to the 7th century. In some Arab countries, it was more important, like in Yemen, for example, or in Morocco, more significant than in Egypt or in Iraq.
Jews were always at the mercy of whoever the ruler was at the time. If it was a generous, kind, democratic, so to speak, ruler, then the Jews even made it to government posts. And you just really always felt like an inferior, I wish I could say only second-class citizen. It felt more like 10th-class, at least, citizen, constantly trying to compliment the Arab, trying to minimize yourself, you know, trying to ingratiate yourself to the individual or the community of Arabs.
The meaning of that, dhimmi, that you have to pay every year for your living, if you want to live. If you want me to guard you, I mean the imam, the government, if you want to continue living as a Jew, you are dhimmi. Dhimmi must pay special tax for his living.
The status of dhimmi, which means the protected people, and applied equally on Jews and Christians, was not always uniformly and equally applied on all lands of Islam. And that law of the dhimmi under Islamic law sometimes was abused of for the wrong, and sometimes Jews got a much better status, in fact, than what was prescribed by the Sharia.
Even when dhimmi laws were not rigidly enforced, the culture of dhimmi, of minority submission, still shaped attitudes toward Jews.
Well, my grandfather was a very famous lawyer, but he would go to the shuk to buy some food, and the shuk, you know, whoever, the vegetable clerk or whatever, would say to him, "Are you a Jew?" And he would say yes. They would demand his money. If he wouldn't give all of his money, they would beat him up.
When I used to walk in the street, little children used to run after me and throw stones at me and calling me, "You are a Jew, you are a traitor," and they threw stones at me. Only little kids.
So we're able to peek through the shutters, and I will never forget the scene of thousands of people in the streets shouting death to the Jews and having big banners and signs, and they were, you know, lifting their fists. I was very fearful, but there was nothing really that we could do except wait until the riot was over.
I was born in Morocco, in the city of Fez, which used to be the capital city of Morocco over many centuries. What I remember from my childhood, because I was there until the age of 13 or 13 and a half, was that I grew up in fear. That's the most striking thing. In fear because every time somebody ran up the stairs, my mother used to run and lock the door. I always ask why. She said, "Oh, the Arabs make Arabs." And then when I grew up, I examined historically, and it turns out in 1912, there was a big uprising in Fez, and a couple of hundred Jews were massacred by the Arabs, Muslims, in Morocco. And since then, the Jews are living together, and they are very much afraid.
I was in school with one of my best friends, Minyawi. We were real close. He's a Muslim Egyptian. One day, we were playing in the field, and he turned around and told me, "Hayag yom hayadbah kull al yahud. One day we will slit the throat of all the Jews." I was shocked. He was one of my best friends, and I couldn't understand it. So this is the contradiction we faced at that time in Egypt when I grew up. The good times and the very bad times. The fear and the prosperity.
While Jews were second-class citizens under Muslim rule, living under Christian persecution was often worse. Many Jews found refuge and relative tolerance in Islamic lands after Christians expelled them from Spain. In modern Middle Eastern cities, Jews were an integral part of the social fabric. Baghdad in the 1920s, for instance, was nearly 40% Jewish, the New York City of the Middle East.
And I remember very well Baghdad. Remember the river, My family used to live not in Baghdad. It was a very nice neighborhood. And we had very good relations with the neighbors.
Well, I remember the River Nile and the pyramids. I remember my friends and my school teacher. And I remember especially the 80,000 vibrant Jewish community.
The Jews of Iraq, they served the state of Iraq very much, more than any other minority in Iraq. The first finance minister was a Jew.
One of my relatives was a very well-known lawyer who drafted the Egyptian constitution for King Fuad in 1924. Now, not many Egyptian Muslims know that an Egyptian Jew drafted the constitution.
I think my father was a very special case because he wasn't really even considered as a Jew by most of his Muslim friends. He was an Iraqi first and foremost. He was not only really very much knowledgeable about Judaism, but also about Quran. And you know, and he could cite many surahs from the Quran, and he understood very well the Quran.
When Muslim was invited to Jews for Saturday, he said, for chunt, tibit we called it, it was very honored to that Muslim that she was invited to Jews.
Leila Murad, she was the diva, the Barbara Streisand, if you will, of the Middle East, and she was an Egyptian Jewish woman who was a beautiful singer. And to this day, people are still listening to her music and absolutely love her. Most Arabs do not know that she's Jewish.
My parents left Iraq around the 50s. I was born here in Israel in the Middle East. I consider myself as a Judeo-Arab, belong to the Judeo-Arab people.
World music artist Yair Dalal preserves and reinterprets Iraqi Jewish music. He learned this art form from Jewish musicians who fled from Baghdad to Israel in the 1950s. Dalal shares his passion with other Israelis and tours worldwide.
I was 2 months ago in Germany for a peace concert. And I met 3 young musicians from Baghdad. They ran away, they escaped. It was in Cologne. They escaped to Cologne from Iraq. And we started to sing and play, and I played the violin and the oud. And after the concert, they came to the stage like they, with full of enthusiasm and tears in their eyes. He said, you know, my father, he's a musician. He always taught me, if you want to study to play good music, to play well, go to the Jews. Study from the Jews how to play. And he said, tonight I'm going to call him to Baghdad and to tell him, I found Jewish young people that play your music.
I listen a lot to Iraqi music. I read in Arabic. You know, we cook the same food that we used to cook in Iraq. So I'm very much Iraqi as well. And this is the problem, because on the one hand, you know, I have a lot of affection for the Iraqi people, but on the other hand, I am very much hurt by what happened to us in Iraq.
A Under European colonial powers, Dhimmi laws were largely abolished and many Jews flourished. But in the 1930s, a tide of Arab nationalism swept the countries of the Middle East as they emerged from colonial rule. Strident Arab nationalist leaders often made Jews a scapegoat for social discontent.
There was a pattern of Arab government, state-sanctioned, indeed state-orchestrated repression, which included intimidation, harassment, beatings, persecution, and even murder.
Many political parties, like even in the 40s, when the Ba'ath Party, of which everybody talks today, was exactly born along this line, some kind of dictatorial, let's say, thinking about the thing that where nationalism was very strong, exactly like National Socialism in Germany.
Haji Amin al-Husseini, the Palestinian Mufti, was meeting with the Führer himself, with Hitler, and proposed a final solution to the Jews throughout the Middle East and North Africa. And the Hitler, of course, was delighted.
In 1940, Haji Amin al-Husseini was the most prominent leader of the Palestinian Arabs and the head of the Arab Higher Committee, the central political organization of the Arabs of Palestine. He and Hitler discussed plans to establish concentration camps in the Middle East. He delivered a radio address to the Arab world on Nazi radio saying, "Arabs, rise as one man and fight for your sacred rights. Kill the Jews wherever you find them." His words reverberated across the Middle East.
In Iraq, in the 1930s, you had the pro-Nazi government, which led to the Farhud in 1941, in which Jews were completely massacred. What happened was that the mobs went rioting through the Jewish ghetto. They would pull babies apart from their limbs till they broke. They would rape women and daughters in front of the families.
They pulled the Jew among all passengers in the bus. Who is the Jew? And they did the Jew out, they killed them outside the bus. Or they entered the houses and they looted. Jews run from roof to roof. In Baghdad, you know, the houses are closed, are very closed, and you can run on the roof. Some of the neighbors of the Jews, they were with those who attacked their neighbors, with the police, and they killed, they looted, and that's what they did, and they forgot all the friendship.
Throughout Libya, Egypt, you know, all these different countries, Syria, you hear all of these instances of riots leading to torture, massacre of Jews.
Al-Yahud Kilab al-Arab, the Jews are the dogs of the Arabs, or Idbah al-Yahud, slit the throat of the Jews, slaughter the Jews. These were not only on posters, but the people were chanting them, and this was scary to see a crowd coming towards you chanting Idbah al-Yahud, kill the Jews.
This wasn't just mobs and demonstrations, this was actual killings of civilians, innocent civilians who were Jewish, and it really created a tremendous fear in the Jewish population, especially for my own parents. My mother had to run through rooftops to escape the mob that was out to kill many of the Jews in her neighborhood.
הייתי בת 13 באותו זמן, בזמן המוראות, וראיתי את הזוועה הזאת, ועד היום, מול העיניים שלי. הערבים קמו והורגים, שורפים והורגים, והתחילו לפרוץ בתים, להרוג, לשבור, לא שיר. ואנחנו פחדנו מאוד.
Thank you. راستي وهي بلاتسي محرا راستي بلاتسي محرا عاش تفسوتي أربيتو قعد كم ماشين مهاس لهم زي السيمان تري رצו لحتوخ את הידיים ואת הרגליים ואת הראש כמו מפה עם גרזנים עשי נמאס להם וחשבו שאני מת.
נכנסתי חדר, מסעתי ילדים, ערימה. שש, שבע, שמונה. קטנים, תינוקות, ככה, עשר. שכל הבית, ערימה אחת. סגופים. ריח של בן אדם, של בסש בדם, ריח אותו. קשה.
My neighbor, who was an Egyptian Muslim, actually saved our lives because he came down and told the mob that was rioting that there was no Jews living in the building, which was not true. My family were in hiding.
In that kind of instability, the only thing you really have left is the trust in a good friend who can help you out of difficult situations, like the righteous Gentiles, you know, the righteous Arabs. And there were some. There were some. You can't let anyone tell you there weren't. There were a lot of Arabs who were very good to the Jews.
Individuals showed compassion, but leaders continued to incite hatred. Arab governments placed new pressures on Jews that made conditions unbearable.
We're talking about Nuremberg-type laws which criminalized being a Jew and characterized Jews as enemies of the state, which stripped Jews of their citizenship, which sequestered or forcibly seized their property and assets.
In 1941, there was one nationalist leader, Kailani, who organized a big uprising against the British occupiers and so on and so forth. And they always, they take the same opportunity to massacre the Jews. And in Farhud, they also massacred the Jews. The British interfered, and after they massacred what they massacred, the things ended. But it has to be always pointed out that anti-British sentiment went with anti-Semitic sentiment.
When I witnessed the persecution, the hatred within the school and within the neighborhood, within the city, within the country of Iraqis, I came into decision, and my mother, my parents also, that country wasn't so our country, and we had to leave.
Bedoun Rukua meant without the chance of coming back, a one-way trip. This is what the Egyptian government did to many Jewish families. When they kicked them out, they stamped on their travel documents, Bedoun Rukua. We don't want to see you again. This is a one-way trip.
Well, in 1948, we were some 100,000 Jewish in Egypt. And now you can find there only perhaps 20, 30 old people. So we could say that the Jewish community in Egypt is not anymore. It's finished, vanished.
As I was watching the door close, and it was a little bit dark, the lights were off, the sun wasn't strong anymore, the curtains were down, and there was this beautiful home, neat, clean, the beds were made, all these beautiful Persian rugs, big rugs, and we were just closing it, and we left.
We left. And we lost everything. We lost the business, we lost his manufacturing shop and his retail shop, and we left behind, unfortunately, a very beautiful villa with a garden full of orange blossoms and lemon blossoms, which till now I can remember.
When we reached the airport, we had no idea what was going to happen. I mean, I had no idea if we were going to see our parents again, if we were going to be reunited again, if we were going to get killed or be let go or nothing. We knew nothing.
The only thing we could take with us were a few clothes. I had left a very valuable and very dear stamp collection, but I did take out with me my Star of David. It was made by my grandfather, and the necklace was made by my father. I was able to get it out, and luckily they didn't search me, because if they had, the Egyptian authorities at the customs would have pulled it from my neck.
In Yemen, Jews faced a wave of rioting. International rescue groups began to plan for an emergency airlift of Yemenites to Israel. But many had never seen an airplane before. Shimon Avi Zemel, a Yemenite Jew who fled to Palestine in 1935, was sent on a mission back to Yemen to rescue thousands of Jews in danger.
When I came to this desert, there were nearly 4,000 people in the desert, in that camp, that terrible camp. There was only early sand and very little huts that they live in. What we had to do, only to teach them, to prepare them for Israel, to teach them the Hebrew. You know, in that desert, I had 2,500 pupils. 2,500 pupils from 3 years old until 60 years old. And they loved the learning, and spirit was very high. In what? In that desert, in that sand, in that terrible heat, you know, terrible heat. They never complained. Why? Because they waited. They helped. They knew that tomorrow we shall be saved. Tomorrow we shall go to Israel. On Shabbat, we read that part of the Torah. It was Parashat Yitro. And in Parashat Yitro, we read that word, Va'esa etchem al kanfe nesharim va'avi etchem. And I shall take you, you know, with the eagle wings to Israel. The Jewish community in Yemen lived the Torah, and they believed that this nesher, Va'esa'et chem al kanfe nesharim, is the aeroplane. And when the aeroplane came the following day, on the Sunday, the eagle, or if you want, the aeroplane, came and took the first wave to Eretz Yisrael.
For those who remained in Arab countries, government persecution only grew more intense. In 1969, Saddam Hussein began his rise to power. As a show of force, he arranged for a public hanging of 9 Jews in the middle of Baghdad. 500,000 people attended the hangings.
And it was shown all over the world on TV, and there were masses of people there singing and dancing, you know, around the bodies. In 1972, it was on the eve of Yom Kippur. After receiving really such sad letters from my father, that he felt so lonely, and he was really hoping that, you know, he get a passport and join us. We heard that he was actually abducted on his way to the synagogue. and we don't know until today what happened to him exactly. We didn't really have Kaddish for my father throughout these years.
In Egypt, following the Six-Day War, the government arrested all Jewish men and forced them into concentration camps.
They took the 400 male Jews between the age of 16 and 60 and put them in these concentration camps. One of them is called Abu Zabal. And they beat them, and they tortured them, and they humiliated them. The things they did, I cannot say, because they are so horrible. My uncle was in there, and many of my relatives were included.
The persecution of the governments of Arab countries made the Jews in Arab countries desire to leave their origin country, but they didn't how, because no country was ready to receive them. So when the State of Israel was established, suddenly we have a shelter, and the Jews came to Israel.
When Israel was created, what it did was it unshackled the Jew from being under the rule and the control of Arabs and Islam. They became free and independent. And for the Arabs and for the Muslims, it is unacceptable for the Jew to be independent, because for 14 centuries, the Jews were under them.
According to the Muslims and the Dhimmi rules, a majority state of Jews, a state where Jews are majority or they are the rulers, is non-existent. It must never exist.
The fledgling Israeli government had little money and faced a war declared on it by seven of its Arab neighbors. Still, 680,000 Mizrahi refugees were taken in and settled in temporary refugee camps called Ma'abarot. They huddled in tents that could barely keep out of the rain and mud.
They were put into tents, wooden huts. More than 10 years, those Jews were in tents as refugees.
My grandmother recalls that when they first got to the Ma'abarot and food was very scarce, and because couscous is a national dish in Libya, and it was not so easily available at the time, she used to take dry bread and dry it up in the sun and make into little bowls just to make it look like it was couscous.
During the country's early years, Mizrahi refugees struggled to overcome social discrimination.
I was really surprised myself how we did it here, because when we came, we had nothing. We were for two years in the Ma'abarot. You know what a Ma'abara is. It's a place with a tent which the government gave us as refugees. I was a refugee for 2 years living in a tent. Imagine in the winter with the cold and in the summer with the heat. So, but what the Egyptian community did here was just, they became a self-made persons here.
The Iraqi Jews are hardworking people. They are very well educated. And, you know, they were in the first line in the Iraqi economy. So, in a way, they shifted all their skills to the Israeli efforts to establish a good economy and a good society.
There are no Jews left in Libya today. The Darvishi Synagogue in Tripoli once overflowed with congregants on the Sabbath and on holidays. Today, it is abandoned and vandalized. Only a few dozen Jews remain in Iraq, Egypt, Yemen, Syria, and Lebanon. Outside Beirut, the Hamdoun Synagogue sits empty. In Morocco, the El Fasseini Synagogue in the old Jewish quarter of Fez is now a boxing club. After Jews fled Iraqi Kurdistan in 1955, this synagogue was turned into a mosque. A dirt road was built over this old Jewish cemetery, with foot traffic exposing Jewish graves. Vibrant Middle Eastern communities that once numbered in the hundreds of thousands are no more. All told, nearly 1 million Jews have fled Arab countries and Iran, and hundreds of Jewish communities have been ethnically cleansed.
Behind every intimidation, behind every silencing, behind every persecution, behind every beating or murder of Jews from Arab lands, behind every property sequestered, behind every assets seized, behind every bank account blocked, we're talking about the historiography of an entire community.
If I say, who are the Middle East refugees, people don't think at all about the Jews. All the people think about are the Palestinians.
Many people ask me, why do you call yourself forgotten refugees? It is interesting to note that in the history of the Middle East, we have been totally cut out of the picture.
The United Nations General Assembly since 1947 has adopted 687 resolutions on the Arab-Israeli conflict. 101 of those resolutions dealt with refugees. But all those 101 resolutions dealt with Palestinian refugees only. It's astonishing to realize that not one resolution, not one of these resolutions ever dealt with the issue of Jewish refugees from Arab lands.
So it was change of population between the Jews and the Arabs. Both of them were refugees.
About 50% of the Jewish population today in Israel is made up of Mizrahi Jews, Jews like myself, who came from the Arab countries. We are the face of Israel.
Anti-Semitism now in the Arab world is 100 times worse than when I lived there. It permeates every sector of Egyptian society and Arab Islamic society. In the mosque, in the school, in everyday conversation, on television. I don't think there can ever be peace unless they can become more tolerant towards their own cousins, the Jews.
I think the only path to peace is when people can open their hearts and listen to the stories of everyone involved. And this means both the positive things, the points of connection between Arabs and Jews, where there's an overlap of culture, and also the points of oppression.
Peace will not depend on my belief. Peace will depend on certain things that have to happen. First of all, accommodation. That is to say, the Arabs have to realize that the Jewish state is here to stay and to make peace with it, and then to negotiate the terms. We want this, we want that, that's legitimate. But if you want to destroy your neighbor, you can never have peace. That's my main problem with them. If there is a recognition and accommodation, the sky is the limit. Everything is possible.
We were so happy when Israel signed peace with Egypt. It was like a dream coming true. We couldn't believe when Sadat came. We were so happy, and we hoped that it will continue with the other Arab countries.
We are here, Jews from all over the world. We are not just from Europe. And this is our culture. And we have to transfer it to the next generation. It's part of our life. It's part of Judaism.
Only when the state of Israel, this is the only shelter, open its gate, we have the shelter, we have the house, our house in Israel. And I am many, many proud, much proud to be Israeli much proud. My grandchildren, grandsons, granddaughter, all of them are serving the army, and they are contributing to the state of Israel as a whole. I wish that the peace takes place between us, between the neighbors.
The peace will come, will appear, must, because each human wants to live. All human wants to live. He wants his family, his children, to continue living. And if we continue this way of killing each other, of these troubles, and so on and so forth, I mean, there is no hope for them, there is no hope for us.
We were really the forgotten refugees, and nobody talked about us. And, you know, we were really humiliated, and we didn't get much attention also. So we swallowed our pain and agony and moved on. On the one hand, it actually improved our situation in integrating in the Israeli society and establishing a new life. But on the other hand, we felt like a great injustice has been done to us.
We don't want to be forgotten anymore. We want to tell our story. We don't want our heritage, which is 3,000 years old, which is rich, to be forgotten. We want our children to remember us so that we can perpetuate the memory of all these 1 million Jews who were kicked out of the Arab world and who will never return, Bedun Rugur.
The Arab governments have taken away our homes. They've taken away our culture. They have destroyed our communities. But they can never take away our spirit to fight for justice.
What's important to me is that the stories of everybody be told, and that everybody's history be recognized and everybody's rights be honored.